Hello, and welcome to another edition of UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Assistant Professor of History at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host. Dr. Ronald W. Walters was an internationally renowned scholar and activist, and an expert on issues affecting the Africa diaspora. He published 10 books, including his award-winning Black Presidential Politics in America, A Strategic Approach, and over 200 articles. He served as advisor to the founding members of the Congressional Black Caucus, campaign manager and consultant for the Jesse Jackson for President campaigns in 1984 and 1988, and he wrote a weekly syndicated column that appeared in newspapers around the country. And he often provided commentary for print and electronic media in the U.S. and globally. Howard University established the Ronald W. Walters Leadership and Public Policy Center to honor Dr. Walters, but more importantly, to serve as a focal point for research, publications, service, and leadership development activities in areas involving the engagement of African Americans in the development of U.S. national and foreign policy, and the role of African Americans in U.S. presidential and congressional politics. This month, Howard University again hosts the Ronald W. Walters Legacy Conference, which serves as an opportunity to bring together his former colleagues and former students, academicians, students, policy analysts, and activists to discuss the impact of Ronald Walters on the academic, policy, and political worlds. Joining me to talk more about the legacy of Dr. Walters and this year's conference is Dr. Elsie L. Scott, Director of Ronald W. Walters Leadership and Public Policy Center at Howard University. Welcome, Dr. Scott.
Thank you for having me.
What an exciting time to be a student of politics and to honor the late Dr. Walters. Tell us about the center and about this conference that's upcoming.
Okay, well, the Ron Walters Center was established at Howard University, and I'm the founding director. And we have established it to try to preserve the legacy of Dr. Walters. And this conference that we are planning on October 10 through 11 is an opportunity to focus on his writings, to focus on what we learned from what he tried to teach us through his columns and through his books. And so we've invited people from around the country with a special focus on people who worked with him and people who studied under him because they are some of the people who knew him the best.
What's the format for the conference?
The conference will be primarily roundtable discussions and panel discussions. We will start off with a panel on Africa and the African diaspora. As you know, Dr. Walters was very much engaged in African liberation activity. Mm-hmm. He was a co-founder of TransAfrica, and he was very much involved with the freeing of South Africa. He participated as an independent, government observer for the election, the first election after the overthrow of apartheid in South Africa. So we've invited some people who worked with him on some of those initiatives and some people who've written about him or who studied his works to talk about his work in that area.
What are some opportunities for students? As you tell us more about the panels and the participants, what are some opportunities for our students to find out about Dr. Walters?
Okay, many students, you know, are too young to really know about him. He was at Howard University from 1971 to 1996, and in 1996 he went to the University of Maryland. And so a lot of the students that we have now may know about him from his writings or what they've heard about from some of their professors, but they didn't get a chance to know him. So what we would like to do is to have students engaged in the conference to come and participate. We are looking for student volunteers who would like to help us manage the conference. And we will also have a public event where you don't have to register, you don't have to pay anything, but any student who would like to come and attend sessions, just come. And we will make certain that if we have the space, we will not turn any student away because they don't have a registration fee.
What are some of the other topics that will be covered?
Okay, as you know, Dr. Walters was not just a scholar. We like to call him a scholar activist. Many people write books and they stay in academia and nobody ever reads their books. The books sit on the shelf and people say, what meaning does it have? But Dr. Walters tried to write articles, he tried to write books that had meaning that people could take and place into practical politics. So we have one panel called Ron Walters, the Activist. And we've invited people like Bill Lucy to talk about his engagement with organized labor. As you know, Bill Lucy was the Secretary General for the AFSCME, the American Federation of Municipal and County Employees, and he was also head of the Coalition of Black Trade Unions. And on that panel, we will also have Bill Strickland, who's a professor at the University of Massachusetts, but he also was very much engaged in African activities and other activities outside of outside of academia. And we have Bill, Dr. Daniels, Ron Daniels, who's from New York City, has been very much engaged in the Gary Convention and some of the other historical events where Dr. Walters was very much a part of. So they will be helping us to put into context how Ron Walters came out of the classroom and was active out in the community. And we'll also have a panel called Race, Politics, and Black Leadership. Ron Walters was one of the renowned experts on talking about race and politics. And so we have some of his former students and other, one young lady, I think she co-authored an article with him, Dr. Andrea Gillespie, who is one of our leading young academicians coming from Emory University. She's done a lot of writing on black leadership. We also have on that panel from the University of District of Columbia, Dr. Sheila Martin. Sheila Harmon Martin will be moderating that panel. Dr. John Johnson, I think he might have taught at UDC for a while, and he's now at the University of Mary Washington. And he was an old friend of Ron Walters, worked with him at Syracuse. So I think we have people who know a lot about the life, about his writings, who will be participating. And for our luncheon session, closing luncheon session, we'll focus on the writings and scholarship of Dr. Walters and Dr. Robert Smith from the University of San Francisco. Some people say that he was Ron Walters' favorite student. He recruited Dr. Smith to come to Howard University to earn his PhD, and Dr. Smith even taught at Howard for a while before he decided that he wanted to go to the West Coast. I think he had family out there on the West Coast. But he is the person that was selected by Mrs. Walters to write the definitive book about Ron Walters. And that book will come out in May. So he will be talking somewhat about what that book will cover, and we expect him to come back to Howard in May or sometime next fall to talk about the book. So we feel like we have a very rich program. And the final panel I need to talk about is called Preserving the Legacy. Because we don't want to just sit back and talk about what did he write about and talk about what he said. But we now want to see what we learned from it. And so most of the people on this panel will be his former students. Mm-hmm. We have Dr. Joe Leonard, who's now the Assistant Secretary of Agriculture for Civil Rights, who earned a PhD from Howard University. We have Dr. Tamalyn Wong, who's at Hood College, who studied under Dr. Walters at University of Maryland. And so we are very excited. And Dr. Diane Penderhughes, who taught at Howard for a while with Dr. Walters, and she was also the first black president of the American Political Science Association. She's now teaching at Notre Dame, but she's a native Washingtonian. So we're very excited that so many people are coming from other parts of the country because they feel like it's so important to pass on to the next generation what Ron Walters was all about and to make certain that we are molding the next generation of Ron Walters.
And when you say the next generation, I think maybe many of the young people would know him from being that political strategist, expert brought on during President Obama's campaign to talk about what that meant and how significant that was and what the political implications of that campaign of having an African-American president.
I'm glad you mentioned presidential politics because that's one panel that I omitted. And that's a very important panel. And so many people know him around presidential politics because he was a strategist, key strategist for Jesse Jackson for the 1984 and 1988 elections. And his book that you had already mentioned, A Black Presidential Politics, many people saw that as sort of a framework for changing the way we look at campaigns, the way we get black people engaged, and maybe we take advantage of getting black people more engaged in political campaigns. So many young people who worked on the Obama campaign had come out of that era of the post-Jesse Jackson movement and studying some of the works of people like Dr. Walters and trying to apply that, because many people say that they learn how to elect a black president by reading about what Ron Walters had to say in his book, Black Presidential Politics. So we are very excited that we have people who will come in and talk about that. And at some point, I hope at the center, we'll be able to bring in Jesse Jackson for him to talk about the role that Ron Walters played in his campaign. Because Ron Walters, you talk to anybody, they'll say he was the strategist. He was the brain behind the campaign. You talk to Representative Maxine Waters, she spoke at Ron Walters' funeral and talked about how she learned so much about strategy just from working directly with Dr. Walters on the campaign. So we have Dr. Laneil Henderson, who used to teach at Howard, who's now at the University of Baltimore. We have Dr. Georgia Persons, who used to teach at Howard and is now at Georgia Tech. They will be coming to participate on that panel.
One of the things that you've talked about in terms of the center and preserving the legacy is the fact that you will be actively doing that. What are some of the events that you want to have at the center to help you do that?
Well, the first event that we've started at the center is the Visiting Fellows Program. And we are so excited that we were able to recruit former Congressman Ron Dellums to come as our first Visiting Fellow. And he started at the center in September. And so he has a very active presence on Howard's campus. In fact, there are so many people excited about having Congressman Dellums on the campus until I've had to screen his calls and emails, because there are so many people that want him to speak in their classes and to help them with their research. But he's a social worker by training, and so by us bringing him in, it has brought the School of Social Work into connection with the Ron Walters Center. Because the Ron Walters Center, many people thought it would just be for political scientists, because Dr. Walters was a political scientist. But it's going to be an interdisciplinary center. And the social work school has a lot of public policy events. So one of the main focuses of the center is going to be on public policy. And so we'll be looking at the implications of Ron Walters' work on public policy. But what we'll also be doing is that we'll be bringing in members of Congress to the campus to talk about current issues being discussed in Congress and how students can be engaged. And we also want to connect our professors with the Congress people so they can do some research. Because what I hear from the CBC members, I used to work for the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation, and what I heard from a lot of the members, they can get research from the Congressional Research Service, but they need research from a black perspective. Mm. And so that's where the center can occupy part of that space. We hope to bring in some visiting scholars, and we hope to have opportunities for graduate students, black graduate students who may be at predominantly white schools, but want to do more research in the black area, doing black politics in other areas, to come to the center and be engaged. And we want to have a nice research institute with focusing on some of the research that Dr. Walters did around political election. Want to look at polling and the implications of elections for black people.
What are going to be, if there is a concluding event for the conference, is that going to be a round table, open forum?
Yes, we have an open forum on Thursday, October 10th at 7 o'clock p.m. at Crampton Auditorium at Howard University. And this will be an opportunity for people who work during the day and cannot attend the conference, people who cannot afford the registration fee. It is an open forum where we will bring together some of the journalists, because that's the other side of Ron Walters. He wrote weekly columns in many of the newspapers, and many people asked him to come on their shows, on their television shows. So we have the Black Eagle, Joe Madison from Sirius Radio. We have April Ryan, who is a young lady who covers the White House and writes a report called the White House Report. We have George Curry. Some people know him from when he published Emerge magazine. He now has georgecurry.com, where he does a lot of blogging and writing about political events. And we have Dr. Michael Eric Dyson from Georgetown University. And the moderator of that panel is a young lady who was a student. But she was a student at Howard after Dr. Walters left, but she had a chance to have him as a teacher because Dr. Walters was at the University of Maryland, and he's to come and lecture at Howard. And she says that the last time he spoke at Howard before he died, I think she had lunch with him before his lecture. And so Stephanie James Brown, Brown James, will be moderating that panel. Some people know her from the NAACP. She was the National Youth Director for the NAACP, and some people know her from the Obama campaign because she was in charge of African American outreach. But we hope that we will have a big turnout of all the people around Washington, D.C. who knew Ron Walters, who knew of Ron Walters, or who want to know about Ron Walters and the Ron Walters Center. And they'll be discussing current issues like the congressional showdown that's going down, whether we should be more engaged in Syria. These are the types of things that Ron Walters would be writing about if he were still living. And so the title of that forum is WWWS. We put it in the lingo of what young people relate to. And that's what would Walters say. And we hope we will have a big turnout for that.
Now, where is the conference going to take place on Howard's campus?
All the sessions will be at the Blackburn Center. Most people who've been on Howard's campus know where the Blackburn Center. But all of these sessions will be there in the ballroom with the What Would Ron Walters Say panel being at Crampton Auditorium.
And now how will people be able to get there?
We're near the metro. I think it's about four blocks from the Shaw Metro Station on Georgia Avenue. And at night, if you come into the public event, usually there's plenty of street parking at night. You come during the day, it may be a little more challenging, plus there are a lot of meters. So if you come during the day, we'd recommend that you take public transportation.
What, as you go and build the center and it expands and you get more support for it, what is your ultimate goal?
My ultimate goal is that the Ron Walters Center will be known around the country as the go-to place for research, especially around Black politics and Black social issues, not just in the U.S., but issues that impact the global Black community. And I wanted to also be known for having policy discussions that engage not just the academic community, but also that are open to the community. Because one of the things that Ron Walters was about was about increasing engagement, the civic engagement of Black people. And so I would like for us to be an impetus, not just for research, but also for activism. Because, you know, when you look at W. Du Bois, and I think Ron Walters came in that mold. Just Friday, I had a chance to see the movie, was a series of movies, documentaries, on the four voices around W.B. Du Bois, and you really get an idea about the activism there. And I know Ron Walters was very much created in that mold, and so I would like for Howard University to make his center a legacy where we will establish that Black people are very much engaged in civic activity, that we are very much engaged in research, and we are very much engaged in molding that next generation of young activists and young scholars.
Is the center going to be a repository for artifacts or other documents on political activity around African Americans as well?
Well, we hope to do some of that. We'll probably do that in conjunction with the library. Dr. Howard Dotson, who was the director of the Schomburg in New York City for many years, is now at Howard University as the director of the library. And so we've been talking with Dr. Dotson about how we can have that relationship. And hopefully at some point we will have some of Dr. Walter's original papers, their repositories, so that people who want to do research around the world on Dr. Walters and his legacy, that we will be the go-to place to do that research.
What part is technology going to play in the conference? For those individuals who come or are unable to come, will they be able to do any podcasts, hear any, or get the presentations?
Well, we're still working on trying to live stream at least some of the sessions, trying to get C-SPAN to cover some of the sessions, and WHUT probably will cover the What Would Ron Walters, the public forum. And so we'll, if people would go to our website, and we'll try to keep that updated with information about how they can connect with the conference. And our website is www.howard.edu/Walters Center.
And where are you located on the campus? Where's the center?
Okay, we are physically located in the Carnegie Building. Many people know where Frederick Douglass Hall is, so we are next door to Frederick Douglass Hall. So we don't really have, you know, we are trying to build out. I was hired to come and build the center. So I came on board a little less than a year ago, and was trying to build the programs for the center, and then we'll figure out what kind of space needs to build out from there. But we are on the second floor at the Carnegie Building.
What was your interaction with Dr. Walters?
I met Dr. Walters when I was a graduate student. I was a political scientist, so, you know, it was very exciting to meet him. I think I probably met him through the National Conference of Black Political Scientists, where he was one of the co-founders of that. And he became, you know, once he met you, he sort of became an informal mentor. And that's the importance of him. So many of us have been influenced by him. And then when I went to the Congressional Black Caucus Foundation, he was the chair of our Board of Academic Advisors. We did a lot of forums together, public policy forums around the country, and he always would give me advice. He would call and tell me when he didn't think something was going right. I remember getting a call from him one day saying, I just spoke to your interns, because he would come over and speak to our interns and our fellows, and he says, these kids don't know anything about black politics. And so he said, you got to make sure you incorporate some historical pieces into the internship program, because you can't assume that they know anything about the Jesse Jackson campaign and so forth. So, you know, I have been very much influenced by him and was very happy when I was asked to be the founding director, because I feel like I have a big weight on my shoulders to make certain that this center is successful. But I'm going to do my best to make certain that I carry on his legacy.
So as this conference, as it looks back at his activities and legacy, as it looks in the present as to the impact on that, and as it looks to the future, how it can be impactful, what part of the conference are you looking at to provide that historical context that he was talking about?
Well, I think it'll be threaded throughout the conference. You know, we have different topics, but what we hope that we will have time for after each presenter is for the moderator to bring it all together, because I've tried to choose moderators who knew Dr. Walters, who knew about his work. So I have Dr. Lynn Jeffries. Many people know him from his activism at City College in New York. Mm-hmm. And I have Dr. Sheila Martin from UDC moderating the panel. I have Dr. Howard Dotson. He's moderating the panel on preserving the legacy. So I have people who knew about Dr. Walters, so I've asked them to try to thread that into each panel. But the panel on preserving the legacy probably is the one where we'll spend the most time talking about how do we take what we learn from Dr. Walters and mold it into the center and mold it into the minds of the next generation.
And that's going to be so important as we try and make sure that young people who are excited about this, were excited about the past two elections, continue to have that kind of excitement as they go forth. What is the significance of taking what Dr. Walters wanted young people to know and having them be actively involved locally?
Well, his last book was on DC politics, and we just didn't have space to put that on this conference. But I hope to do a panel, and maybe I could even do a co-panel with UDC, where we look at his writings about the District of Columbia. You know, he was very much concerned about getting a statehood, getting independence, well, getting at least home rule for UDC. And he wrote a book, co-authored a book, his last book, with Dr. Tony Travis, who's at George Mason University. So he would be very much, you know, if he were alive, he would be very excited if we had students that became more engaged in looking at the District of Columbia, looking at home rule, looking at the impact, because so many people that live in D.C. say, well, we don't really have any power here. But, you know, you have power that you have. I remember Dr. Walters telling a young man, he started talking about not having power, and he said, nobody gave me power, I had to take it. He says, so you need to look at it that way. Don't come up and talk about how these politicians like Charlie Rangel and other people won't step down and let us take over. He says, nobody stepped down to let Charlie Rangel take over. He took the power and decided he wanted to run and ran. So I think that's one of the things we'll be trying to teach the students as to that's what politics is about.
Dr. Scott, thank you for being with us. And once again, the conference is?
October 10th through 11th at Howard University, starting at 9:00 in the morning on Thursday and running through that evening, and half a day on Friday the 11th.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
If you would like more information about the Ronald W. Walters Leadership and Public Policy Center at Howard University or the annual conference, visit the website at www.howard.edu/Walters Center/Legacy Conference. If you would like more information about the University of the District of Columbia, our academic programs or services, please visit our website at www.udc.edu. And if you would like to learn more about the University of the District of Columbia Community College, visit their website at www.cc.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber. This was wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.